Friends, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the ICEA webinar dated 6th of October 2021. Thank you for joining us. ICEA stands for Indian College of Anesthesiologists, and under this banner, we have been conducting webinars for more than 1 year now, which have been successfully conducted and have become popular. And today we'll be dealing with the third module of cardiovascular monitoring, having done two modules in the last 2 months. We have an excellent panel of moderators and speakers. I take pleasure in inviting them. Dr. Manjula Sarkar does not need any introduction. She's well known. And she's the professor at the DY Patil Medical College in Navi Mumbai. She's a teacher for DM cardiac anesthesia, and she has authored many articles, and also she has authored books. Thank you very much, Dr. Manjula, for joining us. Next, I will welcome Dr. Kakoli Ghosh from SSKM Hospital, Calcutta. Again, an upcoming and budding cardiac anesthesiologist with zeal to learn and contribute to the growth of the subject. I welcome Dr. Kakoli Ghosh.
Thank you, sir.
We have four speakers. These speakers are Dr. Vishwas Malik, Dr. Vivek Kumar, Dr. Priyanka Gupta, and Jitin Narula. And they'll be introduced before their talks. And I request Dr. Manjula to take over and conduct the meeting. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, sir, for your kind introduction. Sir is very kind enough for me to introduce me so nicely. Now, let me introduce our first speaker of the day, Dr. Vishwas Malik. Dr. Vishwas Malik is very well-known cardiac anesthesiologist in cardiac fraternity group. He has done his MD from Sri Chitra Institute of Trivandrum, DM Cardiac Anesthesia, AIIMS, Delhi. He is designating the position of Professor, Department of Cardiac Anesthesia, AIIMS at New Delhi. He has many publications and many presentations on his credit. He got many awards and many achievements in this field, and his area of interest is minimally cardiac surgery echocardiography. He is going to talk on the subject that PA versus cardiac output monitoring. I welcome Dr. Vishwas, and you can share your screen for the talk.
Thank you, ma'am. So I hope my screen is visible, Sujesh.
Yeah, please, you can proceed.
So my topic today is pulmonary artery catheter-based cardiac output monitoring. So why do we want to know cardiac output? It's an important component of goal-directed therapy. That is, whenever a monitor is used in conjunction with administration of fluids and vasopressors to achieve certain therapeutic endpoints, thereby improving the patient care and outcomes. All of us clinicians, they wish to improve the patient outcomes. That's why we need to know more data. The scope of this talk will be based intermittent cardiac output monitoring and continuous cardiac output monitoring. Other parameters will be discussed later in the evening. So the three most common principles in relation to the PA catheter are Fick principle, dye dilution, thermodilution. So essentially, it starts from the Fick formula, which is derived from the concept that the oxygen consumed by the tissues per unit time is equal to the amount of oxygen extracted per unit time from the circulation. So it is basically the oxygen extracted from the circulation is the product of the arteriovenous oxygen content difference and the cardiac output. So if we know the oxygen consumption and if we know the arterial and venous oxygen content, we can measure the cardiac output. However, it requires advanced spirometry and oximetry, which might not be feasible in clinical case scenario, and it might not be possible in bedside all in the operating room or in the ICU. So that's why the indicator dilution method was initiated. And here the indicator substance is added to the circulating blood, and the rate of blood flow is inversely proportional to the change in concentration of the indicator over time. So the amount of indicator detected at the downstream, which is point B, is equal to the product of the cardiac output and the change in indicator concentration over time. We will discuss this in a plotted manner. So the based on this premise, the Stewart-Hamilton equation was discovered, and here the cardiac output is equivalent to volume of injectate into 60, which is basically seconds, divided by the concentration of indicator over time. So the indicators, various neutral indicators used are indocyanine and green, lithium ions, and cold saline. Whenever it's cold saline, this means we are practicing thermodilution. If the indicator is the temperature, this means we are using thermodilution technique. So PA catheter has already been discussed, but we'll discuss about some ports. So PA distal port is the distalmost port where we measure the PA pressure. RV infusion port, which is not used for indicator dilution method. However, the proximal infusion port, here the indicator is injected. This means the injected saline is cold ice saline is injected, or a room temperature saline is injected. And the difference in the temperature is detected by this thermistor. So in adults, the injected volume is kept around 10 ml, and whereas in children, the injected volume is kept around 0.515 ml per kg is kept. The resulting change in the pulmonary artery blood temperature is recorded by the thermistor at the catheter tip. So the timing of the injection is crucial for measuring the acute cardiac output, and the PA temperature varies in the different phases of the respiration. So it needs to be done at the end of the expiration, and a preferable apnea is instituted if it is feasible, since there are less temperature fluctuations at this time. So the ideal time of injection of injectate is at the end expiration, and preferable a period of apnea of 5 seconds. So once it is injected, this kind of graph comes on the computer screen, and this graph appears to be a crisp graph, and based on the area under the curve, this is the crucial part of the measurement of the cardiac output. We'll come to that. So this is the area under the curve, and this denominator is basically the area under the curve. This is the basal and the blood temperature. This is the injectate temperature. So the difference between the two is calculated over a period of time. This is the volume of injectate, and this constant is derived by the specific gravity, specific heat, and specific weight of the blood. So based on this, a cardiac output by thermodilution technique is calculated. So usually three cardiac output measurements are performed in rapid succession. If the difference in the measurement is less than 10%, then the cardiac output values will be reliable. If it is more than 10% on each measurement, this means the cardiac output measurement are not reliable. So it is important to know the values in each part. Means we have to take three values, and the difference in the three values should not be more than 10%. So how do we know that there is a significant hemodynamic change? If we have taken only single value, then the next value, if there is more than 22% change, this means there is a significant hemodynamic shift. If we have taken an average of three values, then a difference of 13% is considered significant to label it as a significant hemodynamic change. So we should know the signature graphs. Whenever we measure cardiac output, this kind of graph is more welcome. Means we know that this cardiac output is going to be a reliable cardiac output. The graph is crisp. It has smooth, rapid peak and slow return to the baseline. So this is a normal graph. Whenever there is a low amplitude graph, this means this graph is not going to give us a good cardiac output value. Means we cannot rely on that. However, we need to figure out what could be the reason for this low amplitude graph. This can be inadequate temperature difference, insufficient injected volume, or the speed of injection is slow. Then there is a irregular cardiac output graph. Means either the catheter is hugging the pulmonary artery valve, or there are rapid changes in the heart rate, blood pressure, or respiration. So we need to figure out these before we decipher the graph. So then there are factors which influence the accuracy of thermodilution cardiac output measurement. Majorly the shunts and the tricuspid regurgitation, since there is a recirculation in tricuspid regurgitation within the right atrium, it can either underestimate or overestimate. In right to left shunts, we should understand that whenever we are measuring cardiac output, it is the right-sided cardiac output. And when we are measuring the right-sided cardiac, we are implying the left-sided cardiac output with the right-sided cardiac output. So in left to right shunts or right to left shunts, we are likely to overestimate the cardiac output. Similarly, in cardiopulmonary bypass setting, whenever there are rapid temperature shifts after the beginning of the cardiopulmonary bypass, the difference in temperature might not be accurate to give the accurate value of. So immediately after weaning of CPB, approximately for 10 minutes or 15 minutes or so, since till there is a steady state of hemodynamics, only then we can reliably interpret the hemodynamic data, or we should take the values. Similarly, as we said that we are with PA catheter, we are measuring the right side cardiac output. There has to be respiratory circulatory interactions. So during positive pressure ventilation, because of the compliant right ventricle, there are changes in the right cardiac right sided cardiac output within the cardiac cycle. So that's why we should be very sure that it has to be at a particular phase, that is after end expiration and when there is a period of apnea of 5 seconds or so. Only then we will be able to measure a reliable cardiac output value. Similarly, during low flow states, since there will be a less transit of the indicator, it might overestimate the cardiac output values. So there can be a fibrin or a clot on the thermistor site, distal site, and there can be the sensing problems in the thermistor. So now, to summarize, intracardiac shunts, tricuspid or pulmonary valve regurgitation, inadequate delivery of the thermal indicator because of the excessive volume administration, or thermistor malfunction from fibrinal clot, or pulmonary artery blood fluctuation during the cardiopulmonary bypass can interfere in the accurate measurement of the thermodilution cardiac output measurements. So what are the advantages? It continues to be the gold standard, and multiple cardiac output can measurements can be obtained at frequent intervals without sampling the arterial line. It is cheap, non-toxic, and there is absence of recirculation in thermodilution, unlike dye dilution. However, technique is slightly challenging during the insertion of pulmonary artery catheter, but once it is in place, then the things are in place. We already said that it is inaccurate in the presence of intracardiac shunts, mechanical ventilation or valvular dysfunction, or during CPB weaning. And it is difficult to reproduce the same values. That's why we said that if it is the fluctuation is more than 10%, this may within the two values, this means the cardiac output measurement is unreliable. So how to address the loopholes of the intermittent thermodilution methods? So then another method came, that is continuous cardiac output monitoring, which is now it was cold injected. We shifted to warm thermal indicator, means copper wire were incorporated in the distal portion of the PA catheter, which acted like a continuous injector. Similarly, the difference in the temperature was injected by was interpreted by a thermistor. So the heating filament was cycled in on and off fashion in a pseudo-random binary sequence, and the cardiac output was derived from cross correlation of the measured pulmonary artery temperature with the known sequence of heating filament activation. So typically the displayed values for cardiac output is updated every 30 to 60 seconds. It is not continuous, but there is an element of continuity. However, having said that, it represents the average value for the cardiac output measured over the previous 3 to 6 minutes. So it gives the value of its averages out of the cardiac output values in the previous 3 to 6 minutes. So what are the advantages? We are eliminating the element of human error, and we are not injecting repeatedly, thereby avoiding the risk of infection as well as operator errors. It has more accurate, it gives more accurate measurement of global cardiac output for patients receiving positive pressure ventilation. So the reproducibility and precision, which were the lacunas of the intermittent cardiac output monitoring, they became the strength of the continuous cardiac output monitoring. Moreover, we were getting continuous values of stroke volume, systemic vascular resistance, and mixed venous saturation, giving us an edge in taking better therapeutic decisions. However, nothing is foolproof in this world, neither is CCO. So catheters are more expensive than standard PACs, means they are on double the cost. And the CCO computer and catheter, they require a significant amount of time to warm up. So they may work poorly in an environment where there are too much thermal noise is there in the background, such as cardiac operating room with cardiopulmonary bypass. And CCO monitors have an inherent 5 to 15 minute delay in responding to abrupt changes in the cardiac output. So when we need them most, they might falter. So the examiners are fond of asking the derived hemodynamic parameters. So we should be knowing what is cardiac index, which is basically cardiac output divided by body surface area, stroke volume. We know that the cardiac output in 2000 divided by the heart rate, and stroke index is stroke volume divided by the body surface area. So we should know the value, the normal ranges, which are well available in the books. But the most important here is the systemic vascular resistance, based on which we take decisions whether we need to start vasopressors or we need to start, we give dilators or we need to give fluids. So the average value of systemic vascular, systemic vascular resistance is mean arterial pressure minus central venous pressure divided into 80 divided by cardiac output. Whenever we add I, this means a systemic vascular resistance index, then it is not the cardiac output, it is the divided by the cardiac index. So the values should be we should be remembering by heart. The two values are crucial. One is systemic vascular resistance and the other is pulmonary vascular resistance. It might be very important in cases of taking decisions for left to right, operating decisions for left to right shunts. So the normal range of cardiac output is 4 to 6.5 liters. Stroke volume is 60 to 90 ml. Systemic vascular resistance in Wood's unit is 10 to 20. In Dines, second per centimeter raised to the power minus 5 is 800 to 1600. For pulmonary vascular resistance, it is 40 to 180. And mixed venous oxygenation saturation is close to the heart of examiners, and it is 70 to 80. Thank you.
Dr. Vishwas, for nice presentation. Now we move on the second lecture. Dr. Kakoli Ghosh is going to introduce the second speaker.
Thank you, madam. Good evening, everybody. Now today, after this nice and elaborate lecture on the pulmonary artery catheter and cardiac output monitoring, we move on to our next topic, where I have the honor to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Vivek Kumar, who has done his MD in medicine and DNB in medicine, IFCCM, EDIC, EDSC, FICP, and many more, the degrees in the field of medicine. He is the additional director, critical care, and head of the emergency medicine in Sir H. N. Reliance Foundation Hospital and Research Center in Mumbai. Welcome, sir. He has a lot of indexed publications and also more than 100 national level presentations. He has achieved many awards, honor, and including the commendation by Chief of Naval Staff in 2006, ISSM Presidential Citation in multiple times. His area of interest includes the eco-based hemodynamic monitoring, long-term mechanical ventilation, and simulation-based ultrasound training. Now, he is going to talk on the topic of transpulmonary thermodilution technique of measuring cardiac output. So without delay, we now progress to our next lecture by Dr. Vivek Kumar.
So thank you, Dr. Kakali, and thank you, Muralidhar, sir. And thank you, Professor Vishwas Malik. So I think I start from where Professor Vishwas Malik left, saying that, so everything, the correct way of doing a thermodilution stands, and you need to get a good graph. It is just that there are subtle differences between what Professor has said and what I am going to say. Just one second. So the first thing is that what is the basic difference between a pulmonary thermodilution and a transpulmonary thermodilution? So in pulmonary thermodilution, you inject the indicator into the right atrium and you measure it in the pulmonary artery. While in transpulmonary, you inject it into either the internal jugular vein or the subclavian vein, and you measure it in the iliac artery through a catheter which goes in from the femoral artery. So common sense is that the volume of distribution of the indicator is much smaller in pulmonary thermodilution, while the volume of distribution of indicator is much larger in transpulmonary thermodilution. The larger the distribution, the more the chances of error. Now, the classical pulmonary thermodilution gives us only what is known as the intermittent cardiac output. Similarly, the classic transpulmonary thermodilution also gives us what is only known as the intermittent cardiac output. However, both the pulmonary artery catheters as well as the transpulmonary, platforms have the option to give us continuous variables. And these continuous variables are actually based on pulse contour analysis, which is probably the next lecture. However, their values are calibrated either by pulmonary or by transpulmonary thermodilution. Now, there is something else which transpulmonary thermodilution gives, and that is what is known as the volumetric variables. So basically, people had stopped using Swan guns in the intensive care units, saying that it increases mortality. Although looking very closely, it was difficult cases in which the Swans were used. And of course, difficult cases will have difficult outcomes. So to overcome, I will say, a sort of a false barrier to the use of Swans came in devices whereby you could do thermodilution by a central line and measure it by a arterial line. And these devices got clubbed under the heading of transpulmonary thermodilution. The basics of transpulmonary thermodilution are exactly the same as the basics of pulmonary thermodilution. We need to have a constant blood flow. There should be no loss of indicator between the injection and the detection point. There should be a complete mixing of the indicator with blood, and the indicator must pass the detection point only once. Now, herein comes a small hassle, because unlike the pulmonary artery, here the detection point is much peripheral in the iliac artery. And at the end of it, whichever device you use, pulmonary or transpulmonary, you have to generate a good thermodilution curve. So this is exactly how transpulmonary thermodilution goes in. So if you have an injectate which is injected into the IJV or the subclavian, and it comes in into the right atrium, then goes into the right ventricle, and then moves into the pulmonary circulation, and then ends up in the left atrium, and then ends up in the left ventricle. And from the left ventricle, it goes out into the aorta, into the femoral, and into the aorta and into the iliac artery. So this is a very large volume of distribution for the indicator. And transpulmonary thermodilution actually captures the end diastolic volume of all the four cardiac chambers clubbed in with whatever blood is there in the pulmonary circulation in the end diastolic phase. So this is conceptually what is a transpulmonary thermodilution. And since we capture the pulmonary blood volume, we try to take out many more variables which a conventional Swan will not take it out. The other fundamental difference is that the Swan basically functions on principles of pressure. So you have a PA systolic, a PA diastolic, a mean pulmonary artery pressure, a wedge pressure, an occlusion pressure. And on this side, we have volumes, the right ventricular, the right atrial, the left ventricular, the left atrial end diastolic volumes. And this debate is more in the intensive care and of course in the cardiac surgical OT, is that whether pressure or volume variables, which are better? So to just put it in one line, as measures of cardiac preload, volumetric indices perform better. But when it comes to assessing the risk for pulmonary edema, a pulmonary artery occlusion pressure performs better. And neither the volumetric indices and nor the pulmonary artery occlusion pressure should actually be used to check for fluid responsiveness. These are the same curves which Dr. Malik showed. So the important thing is that when we do transpulmonary thermodilution, there are two things which are used in the calculation. One is the mean transit time, and actually mean transit time in very simple words is 50% of area under the curve. So three things I want to tell you. Area under the curve is actually slightly extrapolated from this point because we cannot take into consideration this. This is recirculation and it spoils the calculations. 50% of the area under the curve, that is the time is, which is known as mean transit time. And the second, for the second equation, we use what is known as the downslope time, and which basically means the time it takes from 85% of temperature response to 45% of temperature response. So these are the two things people should know. Now, in measures of transpulmonary thermodilution, the injectate volume is about 15 ml, and ideally it should be at 8 degrees Celsius. It can be at room temperature. If it is at room temperature, it is easier to do, but it may occasionally overestimate the volumetric indices. If we don't have the jugular or the subclavian, we can use a femoral vein. The calculations are slightly different for femoral veins, but it works well. The thermistor tipped catheter is in the femoral artery, and we can use the axillary artery, brachial artery, and the radial artery also. And of course, we have to just check with the manufacturer if there are any changes in the calculations. Both the venous and the arterial side can be put in the lower limbs, but it should never be put in the same limb. They can be put in the contralateral limb, but when we are using them in the contralateral limb, the cardiac output will be correct, but not the other volumetric variables. So this is a diagram I pulled out from this review article, I think, which is comprehensive. So what are the parameters you get? So I'll put it very simply. When we do a thermodilution, and thermodilution, as Dr. Malik said, is standard, the best of three. And then which are the variables I get? So one variable I get is known as the global end diastolic volume, which is the end diastolic volume of four cardiac chambers plus a part of SVC and a part of the aorta and iliac artery. Okay, this is a measure of actually the cardiac preload. We also get the conventional cardiac output, which is now known as the intermittent cardiac output, and which is as similar to the pulmonary artery catheter, and both are equally accurate. We also get two indices, which are actually the function, which are actually the measures of cardiac systolic function. So you just notice the term. I have not said LV systolic function. They are actually the measures of cardiac systolic function. And one of them is cardiac function index, which I will deal with in a little detail. And other is the global ejection fraction. So these are two parameters which come out from the after the thermodilution. The other things which come out from thermodilution are extravascular lung water and the pulmonary vascular permeability index, which are not the topic for this lecture. However, from the same device, when we do the pulse contour based analysis, we can get what is known as the continuous cardiac output and the stroke volume and the pulse pressure variation, which also is not the theme for this lecture. So it gives us all the conventional values which Swan gives us. It also gives us some volumes like global end diastolic volume. It gives us the cardiac systolic function in a very different way, and it also helps us in calculation the what amount of water in the lungs, and it also facilitates the what are known as something equivalent of a minimally invasive cardiac output monitoring. Now, for doing a transpulmonary thermodilution, when we do a thermodilution and after that we get the cardiac output, we multiply the cardiac output by the mean transit time and we get a figure which is known as the intrathoracic thermal volume. That means the complete volume, whatever is there in the lungs of blood, in the heart, in the pulmonary circulation and in the lungs. And when we multiply the cardiac output by the downslope time, then we get a measure of what is the amount of blood which is there in the pulmonary circulation and in the lungs, which is known as the pulmonary thermal volume. So we get the intrathoracic thermal volumes, we get the pulmonary thermal volumes. And if you see the diagram, when we subtract it, we get what is known as the global end diastolic volumes. And with this global end diastolic volumes, if we have a multiplication factor of 1.25, we get what is known as the intrathoracic blood volume. So you can actually make out amount of blood in the chest, amount of blood in the chest minus the heart, amount of blood in the heart, and amount of blood in the heart, and as well as in the pulmonary circulation. And from this and this, we put it together. And when we subtract, we get the extravascular lung water. So what is very clear is you have to do thermodilution properly. There are no shortcuts. You have to get very good curves. And from those curves, you derive, because from a curve, if you're deriving a cardiac output is one thing, but if you're deriving volumetric variables, the amount of error is phenomenal. Okay. So although this lecture says it's a transpulmonary thermodilution based cardiac output, I'll just first look at the global end diastolic volume, because this is a precursor to the measurement of cardiac output. So I have already discussed that GEDV measures end diastolic volumes of four cardiac chambers plus SVC plus aorta till the point of injection and the point of thermistor. All fine. So therefore, the end diastolic, the GEDV end diastolic volume will be much more than actually an echo-based estimation of the end diastolic volume of four cardiac chambers. First caveat. Second, the GEDV increases as right heart dilates. So the biggest fallacy in using these transpulmonary thermodilution technique is that you are not imaging the heart. So whatever your variables, whether it is especially the volumetric variables, if they are varying, you don't know why they are varying, because they are summation variables. You don't know whether it's the right heart, the left heart, what is getting wrong. So GEDV increases as right heart dilates. GEDV is a good marker of cardiac preload, but pulmonary artery occlusion pressure is a better marker for risk of pulmonary edema. And as far as what we use in intensive care is markers of fluid responsiveness, this is classified as a static marker of fluid responsiveness and definitely not a dynamic marker. Now, when we look at these two variables, cardiac function index and global ejection fraction. So transpulmonary thermodilution derived variables of systolic function. First, we need to measure the GEDV accurately, and cardiac function index is the cardiac output which we get divided by GEDV, while the global ejection fraction is the stroke volume which we get divided by GEDV into four. And the logic is that we assume that the left ventricular end diastolic volume is 1/4 of the global end diastolic volume. Now, both these variables Okay, so in one word, they are variables of cardiac systolic function, but they track changes of echo-derived LVEF very well in most studies. So they run parallel to LVEF. Now, where are the problems with the transpulmonary thermodilution variables? So now I'm talking about both the volumetric variables and as well as the cardiac output. When there is a right heart dilatation, GEDV increases, the cardiac function index and the global ejection fraction decrease, despite the fact that the LV contractility remains unchanged. So right heart dilatation is a googly. The moment there is right heart dilatation, this device malfunctions. So the first thing is, if you are getting values which are not commensurate with the trends or the clinical things, please put an echo probe and look at the right heart. If the right heart is dilated, the game is up for this particular device. The second is that both cardiac function index and global ejection fraction, they are load dependent, as we say in intensive care. So they are both preload. You increase the preload, they will increase. You increase the afterload, they will decrease. So they are not relatively independent markers of the systolic function of the heart. The third thing is that when we use this transpulmonary thermodilution, we don't have any idea of the cardiac structure. We cannot image the heart. GEF is a marker of cardiac systolic function rather than LV systolic function. And this value needs validation by an echocardiogram. So therefore, in the intensive care unit, even till date, I am very, very comfortable using this plain, simple Swan-Ganz catheter. If we need cardiac output measures, then we use the one which has facilities for doing thermodilution along with the cardiac output monitor. For patients in whom we need repeated cardiac output monitoring for whatever reason, whether the organ failure is not turning around and they need repeated fluid challenges, they need repeated adjustments in the vasopressors, inotropes and inopressors. These are the patients we consider for transpulmonary thermodilution. However, the caveat is that their right heart should be normal and there should be no pulmonary hypertension. And at any stage, if they develop that, I think it is better that we understand the limitations. So transpulmonary thermodilution is not reliable for cardiac index less than cardiac output less than 2 liters per minute. It facilitates intermittent measures only. And therefore, it is a big handicap for the intensive care team because we cannot do fluid responsiveness. The small changes, rapid changes cannot be picked up by the conventional transpulmonary thermodilution. There you cannot do a passive leg raising based cardiac output measure. You cannot do an end expiratory occlusion based cardiac output measure. So these limitations have been overcome by adding continuous cardiac output and stroke volume measures based on the pulse contour analysis, which I am not discussing over here. And another big thing is, of course, it cannot be used with ECMO, but it can still be used with our CRRT machine, especially even when we are doing high volume hemofiltration. So therefore, the recommended use of transpulmonary thermodilution is advanced hemodynamic monitoring if RV function is normal and there is no pulmonary hypertension. So I think in my understanding, I think I still love the Swan. It was very good. I don't know why we replaced the Swan with a central line and an arterial line. And if the Swan was played on a small cricket pitch, this is played on a big football field. Chances of error are manifold. There are definitely some advantages of getting things like extravascular lung water and pulmonary vascular permeability index. But I love echoes and I can tell you extravascular lung water. So the estimations of preload, fluid responsiveness, LV, RV, contractility, stroke volume, cardiac output and extravascular lung waters come out very well with the echo and a good lung ultrasound. So that's all from my side. Thank you, everybody.
Let me introduce Dr. Jatin Narula, who is a consultant cardiac anesthesiologist and has done his MBBS, MD and DM in cardiac anesthesia, and also a FIACTA, FTE and EDAIC fellow. And he is now working as a consultant in Narayana Super Speciality Hospital, Gurugram. His area of interest is adult and pediatric cardiac anesthesia, cardiac critical care, TEE and mechanical circulatory devices. He has achieved many awards. And till now, after Dr. Vivek Kumar has described the transpulmonary thermodilution technique, we entered through the IJV, passes through the RV. Now I've entered the pulmonary circulation, came out through the LV into the aorta. Now Dr. Jatin will take us to the other modalities of measuring cardiac output, which are specifically the non-invasive, less invasive or non-invasive methods of measuring cardiac output. So over to Dr. Jatin Narula. You can share your screen.
I'm sharing my screen. Is it visible and am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, yes. And we can see.
All right. I would like to start by thanking the previous speakers for wonderfully highlighting the need for invasive monitoring. Unfortunately, Dr. Priyanka, I am running in your place and hopefully we are seeing your presentation after this. High-risk patients account for major morbidity and mortality, as we all know, and additional monitoring is recommended in these patients to gather information that cannot be reliably gained from clinical examination alone and from conventional monitoring. That's because we know that early aggressive resuscitation limits or even reverses tissue hypoxia. And not all patients are sick enough to warrant the use of invasive lines, whether they are in the perioperative area, whether in critical care, emergency medicine, or in cardiology. So non-invasive basically means, by the dictionary definition, medical procedures not involving the introduction of instruments inside the body. So gathering information about the cardiopulmonary system without entering it in any way would necessitate the need of a third eye, as possessed by Lord Shiva, or with the help of certain non-invasive devices, which I'll be talking about during my session. A small disclosure that ultrasound-based devices like esophageal Doppler and transesophageal echocardiography have been excluded from this discussion, from my talk, as esophageal Doppler and TEE are relatively intrusive when compared to the methodologies that I'll be discussing. Focus will be on newer, completely non-invasive technologies and gadgets. Bioimpedance cardiac output monitoring is the grandfather of non-invasive monitoring. It was developed by NASA and William Kubicek in 1966 to measure cardiac output performance in astronauts. Its basic theory is that with every heartbeat, the electrical resistance or impedance of thoracic cavity changes because of a shift in the intrathoracic blood volume. These changes in the intrathoracic aortic blood volume due to cyclical interruptions of stroke volume alters the current conduction of the chest. Thoracic electrical bioimpedance employs four pairs of electrodes. Two pairs of electrodes are applied to the neck at the base on opposite sides, and two pairs are placed at the level of xiphoid junction. Each pair of electrode comprises transmitting and sensing electrodes. A high frequency 50 kilohertz and low ampere 2 milliampere current, alternating current, is applied to the chest in a caudal direction, and changes in current amplitude between the injected and outgoing current are measured. The first derivative, dz by dt, of the impedance waveform is related to the aortic blood flow. Stroke volume is subsequently calculated by a very complex formula, if we try to understand, which is given by R, the resistivity of the blood, multiplied by square of the length of the distance between sensing electrodes, divided by the square of the length between of the baseline impedance, multiplied by the left ventricular ejection time, times the maximal rate of impedance change. And using this technique, we can determine a lot of indices of blood flow, like stroke volume and cardiac index, cardiac output and index to start off. Then indices of contractility can be determined. Variation of index of contractility, systolic time ratio can be determined. Besides, we can also comment upon the fluid status of the patient using thoracic fluid content and stroke volume variation. However, there are certain drawbacks with the use of this technology, and these include low signal to noise ratio, a higher chance of error, as Z and L are the squared values in the formula, and presumed influence of multiple factors on the chest, like central lines, like intercostal drainage tubes, like external wires, like external monitoring cables, like dressing pads, and high dependence on electrode placement, and presumed electrical interference with cautery and other electromagnetic devices. So a bioreactance cardiac output technique was subsequently developed to improve the signal to noise ratio issues with the thoracic electrical bioimpedance. It is based on analysis of relative phase shift of the high frequency current, just like AM versus FM. These phase shifts are related to pulsatile flow induced changes in the intrathoracic blood volume. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, you are.
There is another room.
You are audible. Just close the box. Close the box.
I'm closing all rooms.
Close it.
It's going on fine?
Yes, absolutely fine.
So phase shifts are related to the pulsatile flow induced changes in the intrathoracic blood volume, and peak rate of change in the relative phase shift is related to the peak aortic flow during a heartbeat. So the advantages are that it is less limited by factors such as body size and pulmonary fluid and patient movement, less dependent on intra and extravascular lung water, and it is insensitive to the distance between the electrodes and has a high signal to noise ratio. Electrical velocimetry is a further advancement in the bioimpedance technology, and it focuses on changes in the compartment with the greatest conductivity, that is blood in the aorta. Orientation of RBCs in the aorta changes from random to alignment in the direction of blood flow upon the opening of aortic valve, and this produces a pulsatile change in the conductivity. This is reflected as a decrease in the bioimpedance during early systole and an increase later. It then derives the mean aortic blood velocity using a transformation equation, and the rate of change of impedance is used to calculate the aortic blood velocity. The stroke volume is then calculated by an equation which uses the normal blood volume in the thorax, which is derived from patient constant of weight and height, multiplied by the mean blood velocity, multiplied by the left ventricular ejection time. And this gives us the values which are depicted on the monitor in a very convenient manner. So where do we stand when it comes to bioimpedance? New algorithms have been developed. There are these pop-ups which are coming up again and again. New algorithms have been developed to reduce the impact of noise. The usefulness in pediatric cardiac output estimation has been shown with reasonable accuracy, and usefulness in determining thoracic fluid content is beginning to be recognized. The partial carbon dioxide rebreathing method is application of fixed principle as previously described by Dr. Malik and Dr. Vivek, and it is based on alternating between rebreathing and non-breathing periods to allow mixed venous CO2 content to be omitted. The NICO NICO monitor has an integrated carbon dioxide and flow sensor, which measures the CO2 production by calculating the difference between expired and inspired carbon dioxide concentration. A correction is applied for the intrapulmonary and anatomical shunt using the FiO2, SpO2, and an adaption of the Nunn's hypothesis. The monitor consists of a simple tubing, simple kit, which has a CO2 sensor, a rebreathing loop, a disposable airflow sensor, and a pulse oximeter. The computer cycles every 3 minutes from the non-rebreathing mode to a 50-second period of rebreathing by adding an additional dead space with a disposable rebreathing loop. A ratio of change in carbon dioxide elimination and the end tidal carbon dioxide after partial rebreathing allows us to calculate the cardiac output. The clinical advantages are that the NICO system is easy to use even without any previous experience and has shown encouraging results in patients with healthy lungs. However, it is limited by the requirement of a stable CO2 elimination, and it is restricted to mechanically ventilated patients with a stable minute ventilation. It causes a transient rise in arterial carbon dioxide concentration, which may go up to 4 millimeters of mercury or 10% of initial baseline. And it is unsuitable for patients with severe hypercapnia, raised ICP or pulmonary hypertension, and it has a relatively long response time. It has been shown that correlation with thermodilution cardiac output in post-cardiac surgery patients has been only moderate. Coming to the volume clamping or vascular unloading technique, it applies three major steps. First is the measurement of continuous beat-by-beat finger blood pressure, followed by transformation of finger BP curve into the brachial arterial BP waveform and calculation of continuous cardiac output from the brachial pressure pulse control. The measurement of the continuous finger BP by photoplethysmography involves wrapping of a cuff around the middle phalanx. This finger cuff LED emitter detector measures diameter of the finger arteries running on both sides of palmar aspect. The cuff pressure is adjusted to keep the diameter of the finger arteries constant throughout the cardiac cycle by sending infrared signals. This is known as the volume clamp method. Continuous recording of cuff pressure generates, therefore, a real-time arterial pressure waveform. Transformation of finger BP curve to brachial artery pressure waveform is then done by an algorithm in the next pin and by a brachial NIVP calibration in the CNAP monitor. Calculation of cardiac output from brachial artery waveform is then performed using the standard pulse contour method. Many recent studies present a reasonable correlation between the finger cuff absolute measurement and the gold standard invasive blood pressure. However, most of these studies have been performed under hemodynamically stable conditions or stable patients under general anesthesia. However, it has been shown that there is better performance of continuous NIVP than intermittent NIVP. The applanation tonometry technique computes the arterial pressure values by processing pressure signals that are recorded by a worked over electromechanical sensor placed over the patient's radial artery using a bracelet. The sensor finds the area of maximum pulse or the applanation position in which the artery's transmural pressure is zero. From the raw arterial pressure, the mean arterial pressure can be determined. This waveform is then scaled according to a proprietary algorithm in the T-line monitor based on biometrical data to derive systolic and diastolic blood pressure. The waveform is also then used to estimate the stroke volume from the area under the curve. There's not much clinical data on applicability and accuracy of this device. And a recent meta-analysis on accuracy and precision of continuous non-invasive arterial pressure monitoring compared with invasive arterial pressure has shown that on account of high degree of heterogeneity with all these devices like NextFin, T-Line, CNAP monitors, these devices do not satisfy the standards of the Association of Advancement of Medical Instrumentation Guidelines to replace invasive arterial pressure measurement at the present. They are also limited by in patients with severe peripheral vasoconstriction, edema, regurgitant aortic valve, in patients with aneurysms, or the finger cuff is restricted to a maximum of 8 hours. However, newer systems with two finger cuffs can be used up to a period of 72 hours. The pulse wave transit time is the time between R wave in the ECG and the pulse wave rise point on the pulse oximetry, which is defined as point where differentiated pulse wave reaches 30% of its peak amplitude. It requires three simultaneous measurements, the peripheral pulse oximetry, non-invasive blood pressure, and the ECG. The pulse wave transmit time has three components, the pre-ejection period, which is the ECG R wave to the rise point of the aortic root pressure and is suggestive of cardiac contractility. The T1 is a time from rise point of aortic root pressure to rise point of radial artery pressure, is suggestive of arterial compliance. And T2, which is from the radial artery pressure to the pulse oximetry wave, is suggestive of vascular resistance. We enter the patient demographic data, attach the ECG, SpO2, it calculates the pulse wave transit time with the help of blood pressure. A complex formula is then used to calculate the estimated cardiac output. The significance of pulse wave transit time has been shown, and it has found to have good correlation with blood pressure and stroke volume, where higher stroke volume and higher blood pressure are associated with a significantly lower pulse wave transit time. However, issues of high percentage error for pulse wave transit time, almost 62% in this recent meta-analysis, has shown that this newly developed technology does not bring any consistent reliability at the present. Future directions include the development of techniques of inert gas rebreathing cardiac output measurement, in which non-invasive assessment of cardiac output is done by means of inert gases like acetylene or nitrous oxide using their washout curves. This allows for ability to obtain measurements in a variety of locations like clinic and hospital using a portable device. The InoCore device or the InoVision is a nitrous oxide rebreathing technique is currently approved by the US FDA for commercial use and has shown promising results when compared with thermodilution cardiac output. Some other future directions include hypotension prediction indices, which involve artificial intelligence applied to cardiac function monitoring. They are available with minimally invasive systems and are under research and development with non-invasive systems. We are changing with the technology, and however, we need to be reminded that with wide heterogeneity in results obtained for various completely non-invasive methodologies, they are not yet interchangeable with pulmonary artery catheter-derived cardiac output. Newer studies with better study designs and adoption of newer algorithms and newer versions of these devices have produced better results. So to conclude, there is a conflicting data regarding measurement performance in comparison with various reference methods. Almost all of them do well in theory, but their performance in clinical situation and practice is doubtful. They seem to perform better as a cardiac output trend monitor as opposed to providing absolute values. And these devices are not yet intended to replace the pulmonary artery catheter, but to provide some relevant information not provided by routine monitoring in certain clinical situations. None of these techniques are mutually exclusive, since their advantages and drawbacks are quite different, and each technology has its own limitations regarding applicability in the clinical settings. So we need to accept and respect them as they are all very different. What really matters is how the generated data are interpreted by the people that use them. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jatin, for this really very high-tech lecture on this very advanced modes of measuring cardiac output, which are specifically non-invasive modes. And these are really very little talked about, and we have never seen all these devices in our day-to-day OT practices or in the ICU. And it really enlightens us. And but still, I gathered one thing from the whole lecture is that still old is gold till no other comparable devices has come, which is as good as a pulmonary artery catheter. Mm-hmm. So right now I'm over to Dr. Manjula Sharkar for introducing Dr. Priyanka again for sharing her slides. Dr. Manjula, are you there?
Thank you, Kakoli. And I have already introduced Priyanka. Yes, ma'am. Priyanka is going to talk on the pulse contour-based cardiac output monitoring. This technique is really gaining popularity day by day, and it is very simple to use it. And people are really liking this technique to be used in the operation theater. So over to Priyanka, and you can share your slides.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm sharing my slides. Am I audible and visible?
Yes, you are.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll start my talk of pulse contour-based cardiac output monitoring. And to start with, again, I would start with the cardiac output, which we know is a product of heart rate and stroke volume. And the aim of monitoring the cardiac output is to improve the cardiac output and the oxygen delivery, which are shown to improve the perioperative outcomes in the, which are shown to improve the perioperative outcomes in the high-risk surgical patients. Yes, ma'am, the gold standard is still the PA catheter, and the major principles and techniques of cardiac output measurements are the fixed principle, the indicator dilution technique, the arterial waveform analysis technique. So I'll be discussing all the cardiac output monitors based on the arterial waveform analysis technique, the transthoracic impedance, and the Doppler principle, which Dr. Jatin has already introduced. So coming to the history of arterial pulse wave analysis, Otto Frank was the first one to introduce the concept of using the blood pressure waveform to measure the blood flow changes in 1899 using the Wynn-Kissel model. In 1904, Ellinger and Hooker, they turned the attention using the aortic arterial pulse pressure to estimate the stroke volume, but the major drawback was they did not consider the compliance of the aortic valve. 1983, Wessling et al. Developed an algorithm which compensated for the aortic wall compliance nonlinearity. So this made the calculation of stroke volume possible by integrating area under the systolic phase of the arterial waveform curve. What is pulse wave analysis? It is the mathematical analysis of arterial blood pressure waveform, and it enables the cardiac output to be estimated continuously and in real time. And also we can assess the dynamic cardiac preload variables like the pulse pressure variations and the stroke volume variations, which are related to the positive pressure ventilation. The basic measurement principles which the pulse wave analysis work on is the Wynn-Kissel model. And we started with the two element model, and it used the capacitor and the resistance. But that could be holding true only if the aortic wall was a rigid wall. But that is not the case. So the third component came, that is the Z, that is the impedance, which used the arterial frequency high and low, but it overestimated the compliance. So the fourth element of the Wynn-Kissel model came upon, that is the L, and that is the total arterial inheritance, which takes into account the density, the length of the vessel wall, and also the cross-sectional area. But the problems didn't end. So Wynn-Kissel model only simulated the behavior of arterial system at the entrance of the system, but not in the periphery. And they did not take into account the wave travel and the wave reflection aspects. So the another technique, the basic measurement principle was the long time interval analysis technique. It is based on the assumption that confounding wave reflection effect, it decreased with increasing the time scale. So the question arises, does the cardiac output monitor invasiveness as we go down by the invasiveness to minimal invasive to non-invasive, does the accuracy decreases? Maybe we are able to answer it in the end. The classification of pulse wave analysis depends on the invasive, minimally invasive, and non-invasive. Invasive, we have discussed externally calibrated the PA catheters and the thermodilution catheters. And the minimally invasive, again, they can be internally calibrated or uncalibrated. In internally calibrated systems, we have the monitors use the demographic data, the biometric data, the waveform characteristics. And the uncalibrated systems use the arterial blood pressure waveform features. The minimally invasive and the invasive ones can be used in high-risk cases, also in liver transplantations and esophagectomies, also in the ICUs. But the non-invasive ones, which have the internally calibrated systems, they can be used in low to intermediate risk surgeries. And they also use the demographic data to calibrate the cardiac output. We have discussed about mainly of the invasive and the non-invasive ones. A little bit about the invasive externally calibrated. The reason for including them was that they used both the thermodilution as well as the pulse wave analysis method. So we have 2 to 3 monitors like the Pico Plus and the volume view and the EV1000, which estimates the cardiac output using the pulse wave analysis based on the area of the systolic part of the AP curve. We've already seen this and has been detailed discussed. The other thing which sir said about was the ARDS, the use of these catheters in evaluating the extravascular lung volume and the vascular permeability, which could again differentiate between the cardiogenic pulmonary edema and the pulmonary edema due to pulmonary due to the ARDS. So these were the studies where the ARDS also severe ARDS showed that the transpulmonary thermodilution systems can improve the patient's outcome. Another system which is into play is the Lidco Plus system, and it uses not the pulse wave analysis, but it uses the pulse power analysis, which is a non-morphological system, which translates the arterial pressure volume signal to arbitrary units, and it is site independent. So we can use it in any site, not major arterial catheters, and it has less of dampening effects. But again, it comes with the contraindications that it cannot be used in the first trimester and less than 40 kgs of weight. Coming on to mainly the pulse wave analysis methods, the minimally invasive cardiac output monitors with internal calibrations. In this category, we have the FlowTrack, Vigilio, and the EV1000 monitors. These monitors, they estimate the cardiac output from invasively obtained arterial pressure waveform without calibration to an external cardiac output measurement. Thus, they do not require a central line. So that is an added advantage that they can be added to the arterial line So that is why they are referred to as minimally invasive pulse wave analysis system. The flow track system is based on the arterial pressure based cardiac output algorithm. So every company has the proprietary algorithms on which they give us the cardiac output. It analyzes the pulse pressure characteristics to beat basis and corrects it for the change in arterial compliance and resistance. The vascular tone is estimated based on the mean arterial pressure and the AP waveform characteristics. All these variables, they combine together into factor chi that is continuously updated and used for cardiac output monitoring. This is how the flow sensor is connected to the arterial line and they take the pulse contour analysis. The proprietary algorithms are used and they give us the cardiac output. This is a study of 2013 in JCVA journal where they compared different multiple software versions of for the accuracy data, and they calculated the percentage error of 13% to 75%. We can see on the right side the percentage errors of 13%, 33%, 39%. So different percentage errors are there, and I would like to tell that the percentage error of less than 30% is what is acceptable. Another study which was given in the clinical of 2016, they showed that there was an improvement in the fourth generation flow track Vigilio systems for tracking the cardiac output changes. Another study which I would like to quote here is the 2017 study of JCVA, where they compared the flow track generation catheters with the thermodilution techniques and the 3D echocardiography, and they found that the cardiac index measurement by the fourth generation had a wide limit of agreement with that measured by the three-dimensional echo, and the percentage error was 59%. So that is quite not acceptable. Also, the patients given the phenylephrine and cardiac ease synchronization therapy were measured by concordance rate, and those both were below the acceptable limits. Another cardiac output monitor, which is widely in use, is the ProAQT monitor, and the sensor they use is the PulsioFlex sensor. This is the study of BJA and of 2014, where they compared both the PulsioFlex and Vigilio to track the changes of cardiac output in critically ill patients. And they found that the PulsioFlex did not reliably estimate the absolute value of cardiac index, but they tracked fluid-induced changes in cardiac index. So PulsioFlex was reliable. Contrary to this came a study of JCVA, which is recent in 2020. And they said that comparing again the Schwann-Ganz catheter and the PulsioFlex, when they did the response to volume expansion, they considered that it was only positive for 12 cases in Schwann-Ganz and only 2 cases in PulsioFlex system. So they gave that it is moderate after cardiac surgery, the concordance between both the things, but PulsioFlex did not correctly track the changes in cardiac index during fluid expansion. This is a comparison of different cardiac output monitors. And this we have already seen. Another study of BMC anesthesiology, in 2021. This study, they again evaluated with the thermodilution technique and a new monitor, which is known as the Agio monitor, which works on the multi-beat analysis. And this is on the right side, the Bland-Altman plotting. And it shows the root metered square errors where the concordance in thermodilution Vigio flow track is 72%. For Agios, it is 87%. So they concluded that in comparison with the cardiac output monitors by PAC, the Agios device is said to be better than the Vigio flow track device in cardiac output trending and absolute cardiac output measurements in off-pump bypass surgery. I'll be showing two meta-analyses, one in 2010 of anesthesiology review. Again, they said that the acceptability agreement was only 30%, and they did a study with 47 studies, meta-analysis, and they found that no cardiac output monitor then had achieved an agreement with bolus thermodilution, which meets the expected 30% of the limit. This is in 2017, a review meta-analysis on the accuracy and precision of non-invasive cardiac output monitoring devices. And the key point of the editor are very interesting. The advances in non-invasive cardiac output technologies offer simple perioperative monitoring, but the accuracy is again questioned. So this meta-analysis found modest agreement and inadequate percentage error for most of the technologies. The novel non-invasive cardiac output technologies are typically developed in relatively healthy populations. Their internal algorithms may thus be inappropriate to major surgery or critical illness. The percentage error and trending are important variables in evaluation of non-invasive cardiac output techniques. Another thing is the minimal invasive, the uncalibrated models. In this, we use what we were talking, Dr. Jatin, the PRAM, the pulse recording analytical method algorithm that allows beat-to-beat impedance estimations and further calculation of hemodynamic variables like stroke volume or cardiac output. The system is the most care system, which is connected to the monitor and obtains a continuous AP waveform, and it monitors the cardiac output. The study on the most care system in 2017, it included 400 patients, which showed an acceptable agreement between most care and transthoracic echocardiography with the percentage error of 27%, which is acceptable. The non-invasive internally calibrated system, which Dr. Jatin has already told, the CNAP and clear system and the applanation tonometry, the volume plan and these are discussed. This was a study of CNAP system, which showed that if it was calibrated, then yes, the percentage error is only 25% and it is useful. And this is for the T line. So putting it all together, the initial question, the cardiac output monitor, as the invasiveness decreases, does the accuracy? So yes, 2016, they said that indeed less invasiveness indeed seems to imply less accuracy. Yes, its trending abilities are acceptable. In perioperative settings, pulse contour analysis-based monitoring can be indicated to apply goal-directed hemodynamic therapy. So transpulmonary still remains the gold standard, and pulse contour analysis can be calibrated, auto-calibrated, non-calibrated. Beat-to-beat values of BP, heart rate, stroke volume, cardiac output, stroke volume variation, and pulse pressure variations can be taken. It is useful in the OR during the goal-directed fluid therapy and may be, yes, useful in the ICUs. A study which showed in 2014, which said that how do and when do we adopt a continuous non-invasive monitor? It says that we have to be flexible in case we have a high-risk surgery or the intensive care unit with the high-risk patients. We should be using continuously invasive hemodynamic monitors. In case there is an intermediate risk surgery, so we can step down to the continuous non-invasive hemodynamic monitors. And yes, if we are using in a low-risk surgery, the intermittent non-invasive hemodynamic monitors, we can step up to the continuous non-invasive if the risk of the patient increases. In critically ill patients with the less invasive hemodynamic monitor, again, they said that the non-invasive monitors are increasingly used in high-risk surgical patients, and continuing technology refinements will probably make them become the hemodynamic monitors of the future. Talking of the future, we may be seeing bioimpedance necklaces and the implantable sensors, chest patches, which could be connected to our phones, the apps, and we could track and share the physiological signals and record the EEGs or ECGs. This was the study of the sneak peek into digital innovations and variable sensors for cardiac output monitor in 2016 of Journal of Clinical Monitoring and Computing. So my take-home message is it is obvious that the existing literature that different cardiac output monitoring techniques have their own limitations, and no single device can meet all the clinical requirements. We need further evidence of complications and accuracies of minimally invasive cardiac output monitor devices when used in routine practice. Minimally invasive cardiac output monitor devices adds numerical trend and information for the anesthesiologist and intensivist to use in determining the most appropriate managements of their patients. What really matters for all these devices is general, and is how the generated data is interpreted by the people that use them. Thank you, ma'am.
How we are going to move towards the future and how the technologies are going to help us in the future. As Kakoli said it, that old is gold, so there is no doubt that PA catheters are giving us many variables and many data for managing the patients. But if you see that today's world, that pulse contour analysis is really helping us, and that is not giving that wide data to us, but it really helps us, and we can manage our average patient in operation theater and CCU. But if we move towards the critically ill patients, or where we need the more data for the management of the cases are concerned, that these monitors are really good. As Jatin has said it, and Priyanka has said it, that research is really required in all the fields. So cardiac field also needs the research. And I hope that in future, we will be in position to monitor our patients by putting the necklace, as you said it, for managing with impedance. And there is only one question, I think, in the chat box. Let me see the question. Watch out is helpful in predicting hypovolemia and vasopressors. Dr. Bhuvan Pandey has asked, and this question is for, I think, Dr. Vikram. Dr. Vikram is there?
Yes.
Dr. Vivek.
Dr. Vivek, madam.
Dr. Vivek, sorry, Dr. Vivek.
Yes, I am there.
Yeah.
Can you just repeat the...
Dr. Bhuvan has asked,
is it helpful?
Helpful for predicting hypovolemia and vasopressors.
With vasopressors.
Right.
So, definitely. So, if you have a transpulmonary thermodilution device with pulse contour analysis monitoring, I'm keeping it physiological, which comes in the market by the name of either PICO or volume view. So if you have a volume view with the EV1000 monitor and you are doing intermittent transpulmonary thermodilutions, as well as you are monitoring continuously a pulse contour based cardiac output. So you will also be getting the systolic pressures, the diastolic pressures, and the mean arterial pressures. So the moment there is hypotension, you will actually exactly know that whether the patient needs volume. So it is quite possible if the patient is in steady state and the stroke volume variation has been around 7 or 8%, and the stroke volume variation then becomes 10%, then becomes 12%, and then the systolic blood pressure drops. That means the patient is fluid responsive, and that is why he has become hypotensive. That is one. But this is one. So in that case, two things: you give a fluid bolus, and if the stroke volume variation reduces and the blood pressure comes up, it's fine. If it doesn't do so, then you have to do a recalibration by doing a thermodilution, and then again check the stroke volume variation values. And if it is still not in congruence, then you please put a probe and specifically look at the right heart, whether what has gone wrong. So hypotension can be predicted by, one is a change in stroke volume variation values, the trends of which are slowly and slowly increasing to a cutoff figure of above 12%. Similarly, if you are monitoring the global end diastolic volumes, but the thing is that, you know, stroke volume variation is a continuous thing. You can get it continuously. Global end diastolic volume, you get it only when you do a thermodilution. So if you have a stroke volume variation which increases, the pressure drops, and if you do a thermodilution and the global end diastolic volume is reduced, there is no doubt this patient needs volume and is fluid responsive. However, if you have a hypotension and before that you have noticed that the cardiac function index and the global ejection fraction in the last thermodilution were a borderline, and now you're finding that you're continuous, so whatever you pick up, so you will be on a pulse contour analysis only. So if the continuous cardiac output is going down, stroke volume is going down, stroke volume variation is not increasing, patient has still not become hypotensive. In that case, please do a thermodilution. Just check at the CFI and the GEF. If they are down, that means probably there's a myocardial depression setting in. But if they are not down, then I suggest please do a echo, check the chambers. And if they are not down, then you really have to see that whether is the patient vasodilating.
So you mean to say 2D echo is must in all these cases?
So whenever there is a alteration,
alteration. Okay. Yeah.
One is it has to be significant. So like in the case of Swan, it is same. At least 12% changes have to take place from the previous readings for it to be called significant. And any significant change, you know, one is by common sense, you troubleshoot. But if it is not resolving, please do one, a thermodilution, recalibrate the device as well as put an echo probe and just look at the right heart.
Thank you. Now, Dr. Rajesh Arya wants to know, continuous cardiac output using PA catheter has lot of fallacies and time delays from measurement to the display on a screen, which makes it little less of help in the sick patients where we are planning for goal-directed therapy. So this is what he has commented. Now, Dr. Rachna Vadva wants to know that which non-invasive way of monitoring is better? I think Jatin can answer this question.
Yes, ma'am. So to take forward from there, I think as I presented in my talk as well, that there's no particular technique which is, I would call, better than the other one. Because till now, none of them have been able, none of the studies have proven them to be more efficacious than the gold standard PA catheter. Mm-hmm. But of course, depending upon the clinical situation, whether if there is a, you know, there is a patient who in the ER has come with a, you know, sudden hypovolemia, we want to know, we can just put in an echo probe and get a lot of information at that instance. The thermo, the electrical bioimpedance has a very small lag response time. Whereas if you wait for a insertion of a sheath followed by a PA catheter and then, you know, picking up the values from the PA catheter. So the decision for the best device depends on the clinical situation and its applicability and the situation where the patient is.
Okay. What about esophageal Doppler? Because that can be kept for long in esophagus and can give beat-to-beat analysis of left heart cardiac output.
So the issues with esophageal Doppler are manifold. Number one, it detects the flow in the descending thoracic aorta. So the 30% of the flow, which is presumed to be going into the upper body circulation, is subtracted in this its algorithms. Mm-hmm. So that's one presumption in it. Number two is that, of course, because it is echo based, it requires orientation with the signal, and it is operator dependent that the orientation of the Doppler beam with the flow has to be accurate. Mm-hmm. And third issue with that is that it's presumption of the size of aorta for calculation of the cross-sectional area in the esophageal, which is based upon the height, weight and demographics. So if there is an aneurysm or the aorta is dilated or there are any issues with the alignment of the beam, then it will be inaccurate. A TEE would be better, I would say, because in that we can directly estimate the cross-sectional area. It would be more accurate and we can visibly align the beam.
So in a particular type of the cases, you recommend the esophageal Doppler, not in all cases. And TE is definitely better, going to give us better idea about the scenario. Dr. Murali sir wanted to say something. He's raising his hand.
Jatin, very nice presentation. In fact, all of you have done extremely well, more than what I expected. Very nicely done, all of you. I was wondering about this nitrous oxide technique you mentioned. So if you use that technique, I think the candidate, the patient will start laughing and we get the cardiac output when the patient is laughing.
Maybe it's another drawback of the study.
So that will be laughing cardiac output.
But at the same time, you would be have some stress of or some, I mean...
So cardiac output will raise or will be low when the
It will go up. It will go up. Patient, the person is laughing, so the cardiac output will naturally will go up. I think so.
Yes, sir. And the sympathetic stimulation will be there.
Yeah. And the drawbacks for bioimpedance, I would like to add that if chest is open, these techniques will not work. For example, if you are doing cardiac surgery and you attach these leads, I think they give all sorts of fallacious readings. We have tried it out, and that is one thing. And if the patient's chest is congested, again, I'm not sure that they will give accurate reading or reliable readings. And my question to Vishwas is that, Dr. Vishwas, there has been a lot of controversies about PA catheter use. What are your indications for the PA catheter use in your setup? Where do you use it?
It's a combined valvular and cardiac surgery. That is one, say, aortic valve replacement plus CABG.
Right.
In off-pump CABGs. And then...
do you use in all off-pump CABGs?
Not all of them. LV dysfunction less than, ejection fraction less than 30%.
Right. Thank you for that.
My question to Dr. Jatin is that in case of pediatric patient, if you need to, for the sick babies, if you need to monitor the cardiac output, which device will you, recommend?
When it comes to pediatric cardiac output estimations, we really are short of methodologies. And mostly it is either bioimpedance based or echo based upon TEE and transthoracic echo. Most of the other technologies in pediatric cardiac output estimations have not shown good results. So mostly for perioperative settings, we are relying on TEE, echo, and some studies with electrical velocimetry based and bioimpedance based studies are coming up. But then again, as Dr. Muralidhar said, post cardiac surgery, the outcome is
accurate.
I would add to that, ma'am, whatever sir said, right? Impedance in pediatric, a new study which I had read was about the NICO monitor. It is again based on the impedance. And again, the same problems, if the chest is open, it will not measure correctly. But yes, in other cases, it is showing a promising result in pediatric patients. The NICO study is again based on the fixed principle they used.
Yes. One question to Dr. Vivek. The stroke volume variation and pulse pressure variation derived from the transpulmonary technique, does it have the same disadvantages as the usual stroke volume variation? For example, you have to have a tidal volume of 8 mL per kilo.
Yes,
and
sir.
It should not be any arrhythmia. Same principles will apply.
Same. So it's just like they have added pulse contour analysis, but across the spectrum for pulse contour analysis, you should have a patient who is mechanically ventilated, sedated, and paralyzed, and getting tidal volume of more than 8 ml per kg in a normal sinus rhythm with a normal RV. So actually, when they studied it in Europe, they found less than 18% of patients are eligible to fall into this category, and therefore less than 18% are actually eligible to go in for what are known as dynamic measures of fluid responsiveness. Right. So the limitations are across the board.
Right. Thank you for that. And is the pulmonary vascular permeability index a good predictor of impending pulmonary edema compared to pulmonary artery capillary occlusion pressure?
So it is good, sir. So see, you, if I look at a critically ill patient, so one is the pulmonary artery occlusion pressures may go up either when the patient is getting fluid overloaded or may go up when the LV systolic function is going down. I presume that since we are in the ICU, there are no regurgitations, but the biggest thing is when hearts get septic or when the patients are critically ill, there is an element of diastolic dysfunction which takes place and LV compliance goes down. Yeah. So there may be an elevation in pulmonary artery occlusion pressures just because the chambers have become stiff. And even at higher pressures, the patients may still be volume responsive, although they may be at risk of slipping into pulmonary edema if you don't do it in a very calibrated way. So when we look at this extravascular lung water and pulmonary vascular permeability index, the first parameter is the extravascular lung water. First, the lung water has to increase. And if it's increasing, then you need to know whether it is increasing because of an elevated capillary hydrostatic pressure or it's increasing because of leaky capillaries. So extravascular lung water can predict the development of pulmonary edema. But once it's developing, PVPI can only differentiate between inflammatory versus hydrostatic.
I think that's a good response. Thank you so much. And
thank you, sir.
flow track has no validation in the presence of atrial fibrillation. This question is for pulse contour.
Yes, sir. So that is true. It will not have a validation. Again, what sir said, that it is the sensor is connected to the arterial line. So any dampening effect or any of these situations, it will not give a correct reading. That is what we is the issue with these catheters.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Any other questions are there? Dr. Manjula?
No, I can't see any other question in the chat box. And I think it was a really nice presentation from all the speakers and good discussion. So we know that limitations are there for everything and everywhere. So we have to decide what we have to do and how we have to proceed for which type of the cases. So we can select the case and go. Regarding that PA catheter you asked from Vishwas, even I will say that when the ejection fraction is less than 35%,
yes,
and we are doing on off pump surgeries, we should put the PA catheter. That really gives us good monitoring of the patient.
Right.
And even FlowTrack is doing well for the all cardiac surgery in the adult patients. So we can go ahead with the FlowTrack also.
Right. Kakuli, do you want to say anything on the presentations and?
Sir, in our government hospital, government hospital setup for the patients with low cardiac output, we regularly use the PA catheter in our OT. And sometimes we have seen, and these are very basic PA catheters. They are not always a four or five tailed catheter many a times. We only get a supply of three tailed catheter with a facility of getting only PA pressure and occlusion pressure if required. So in that cases, we have also seen that the PA diastolic pressure is good enough to monitor for the development of, but I mean, maybe it's to some extent a crude method, but it is really good and helpful for our residents and all our OT, anesthesiologists to prevent the impending pulmonary edema if we just monitor closely the diastolic pressure of the PA.
Sure.
PA
catheter. Do you do the SVO2? Do you do SVO2 with PA catheter?
Sir, yes, we do sometimes.
Okay. Any of the speakers wants to add any point?
Sir, I think Vivek here. I think we've discussed everything, but from my side experience, and across all spectrum, ICU, cardiac surgery, non-cardiac surgery, I think echocardiography remains a very, very good tool where you can actually do everything. It is absolutely non-invasive, and with some training, it is not so operator dependent, and the transthoracic is absolutely non-invasive, and it works well. I mean, you can do your stroke volume, you can do fluid responsiveness, you can do extravascular lung water, and you can see the LV and the RV functions also. And it's so whenever if even from a transpulmonary, if I have to go on to echo to interpret and correctly analyze a change, it is better that we have one good echocardiographer in every OT, and which is definitely there, who can just, put the things in there. So I think the role of echo somehow did not come up. So we presumed, since we all do it, but I think that should come out as one of the modalities which is consistently performed well.
Actually, we covered echocardiography in a previous webinar, so that's why it was not included here.
No, I think Dr. Vivek is right. And in due course of the time, I'm sure that 2D echo is going to take place of like an ECG monitor in the operation theater. And all the OTs are going to have the 2D echo machine, I'm very sure. Because it is not helping us in the cardiac OT only, it is helping us even in the non-cardiac OTs also. Whenever we are doing any case which is related to cardiac disease is concerned, it is really helping us. So quick assessment by 2D echo is really helping us even managing cases in the non-cardiac.
Yeah, setups. Yeah. Now the handheld echocardiography machines are coming.
Yes, yeah.
And they may replace the stethoscopes. That is the prediction.
Yeah.
And these echocardiography machines are artificial intelligence enabled.
Huh.
So even a relative novice can get the LVEF and B lines on the lung fields just by application of the probe onto the chest.
Yes. So I happen to be the reviewer for that article.
Oh, really? Thank you so much. I think it is time to go for dinner now.
Yeah.
And it's my pleasant duty to thank the moderators, Manjula Sarkar, Kakoli Ghosh, for efficiently conducting the meeting. Very well done. Thank you so much. Your comments are very apt and they are apt and suitable. And I would like to thank Vishwas, Vivek, Priyanka, and Jatin for their excellent presentations. I'm really happy they did well. I mean, beyond my expectations. Thank you so much. And we'll meet you again on the 16th for the WCA special meeting. This is on new NPO guidelines for children from a presenter from Philadelphia. Please join us. And we will be having another webinar on the other aspects of cardiovascular monitoring next month. I think it is on the 6th, I think, or 3rd of November. I don't know. I'll tell you the date later. Please join us. And Sanish, you want to say anything?
No, the only thing that was about the October 16th program. In addition to next Wednesday's program,
yes,
October 16th, we'll have a special meeting.
Yes, yes. Thank you, everyone. Okay. Thank you, IC.
Thank you, and goodbye, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you,
sir, and good night, everybody.
Very well done. Good night.